from Rice University, where students watch things on reading days. It's General Physics 2. Today, resistors and DC circuits. Dr. Stenson. Also, a top 10 list. And now, a man who wasted quite a few yogurts because he didn't understand the concept of fruit on the bottom. Professor Hafner.
Hello. Okay, my mic works too. Hey, how's it going? Welcome back to Physics 126, the wild, crazy version. All right. Shit, I can't see anything. Dr. Stenson always takes over in my view. Right at the back. It's all his fault. Everything that's wrong in my life is Dr. Stenson's fault. It's okay though, you know. Oh, can everyone hear this? Oh shit. Now I can see myself. This is what I do all day. I stand in a room with a camera on myself and I look at myself all day. Oh yeah. So you can tell too, because you know when I'm looking at you and I'm looking at myself. Now watch the lectures, always looking at myself. I'm just checking the board. Okay, so, where are we? So we're starting to do circuits. Today we're gonna do one more little sort of physical circuit, and then we're gonna do RC circuits. And then wherever we finish today, that's it for the exam. There's one kind of weird kind of circuit I don't think we're gonna get to, so I'll probably just remove them from the homework and we won't do them on the exam. So yeah, so whatever we get through today, that's what'll be in the exam next Friday. Okay. Before we get going though, I want to tell you, I got an email last night from a representative of a country with a lot of people and a lot of resources. And they want to pay me $250 an hour to teach online physics. So I'm not sure what Rice pays me, but I'm pretty sure it's not $250 an hour. So I'm not sure where this is all headed, but I'll at least be here through next week's exam. So, you know, if you see the president and the provost and you want to tell them the word on the street is Hafner's time is worth $250 an hour, you might want to let them know. All right, so there is one kind of resistance measurement from your everyday lives. Are the optics and lenses stuff we're doing next week on Friday's exam? No, would I do that to you? Would we lecture something on Thursday and give you no homework about it and then put on the, would we do that? Do you still distrust us that much after a year of gentle physics with review weeks, cut topics? No, they're not on. And I'm sorry to make fun of you, but I don't know who you are, so it's fine. I don't see, it makes it easier when I don't know who the names are. Hopefully you posted that anonymously. If not, I apologize. Okay, so the kind of a measurement where a physical measurement is like, I have this scale in my bathroom. And I stand on it, you know, and it tells you your weight, but then it tells you your body fat percentage. Like, I don't know, how does that work? You know, I've always wondered. I used to think that was like a camera in a data center and somebody's like, yeah, but no, I think I've learned it's actually an electrical measurement. So let's look at body composition measurement. I want to tell the data center, this is not a good angle for me. But then I realized, no, it's actually an electrical measurement. It's exactly what we've been doing. So let's look into it, okay? What it comes down to is the fact that the resistivity of fat cells, you know, of fat as a tissue, is different from muscle. So fat is 26 ohmmeters, and the muscle resistivity is 13 ohmmeters. So a factor of two difference between those two resistivities. So let's imagine they have these meters for different parts of your body. And something about a membrane here. First problem does, I can't talk about the pledge. So yeah, you can email Dr. Stenson if you have a question about the pledge because he can control that the information goes out uniformly. So let's say you're measuring this from an arm instead of my bathroom scale, you know, something clamps here, or maybe you hold it across both arms. some electrodes, and let's estimate some dimensions here and what's going on and what kind of a measurement it's making, because it's actually, we can understand it with our simple 126 concepts. And instead of thinking of your arm as this mixture of fat and muscle, and let's just forget about the blood and the bone, let's pretend those are just insulators, and let's say some level of it is muscle and some is fat. So let's just pretend it's like solid muscle down here and solid fat up there. Because the way this current's going to flow, it's going to go through one or the other. Big long strands of muscle, big long strands of fat. So we can just think of them as separated, and then it's kind of like two resistors in parallel. All right, that's how this is going to work. So let's say, you know, your diameter of your arm is 8 centimeters and the length is like 25 centimeters, something like that. And let's say it's X percent fat. Therefore, it would be 1 minus X percent muscle. And here I'm being like a grown-up, and I'm going to define this as a decimal. I'm not going to call it an actual percent. All right, so maybe it's 0.2 here. It's got to be 0.8 there, pretending that everything is muscle or fat. Okay. So let's see. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to say rho naught equals 13 ohm meters. So we're defining our resistivity in terms of the resistivity of muscle. So fat, you can see, is basically 2 rho naught. So that'll help make it less sort of annoying. Okay, so let's apply delta V to both. What are we gonna get? Well, delta V equals I total times R of the arm. This is how you would approach this, you know, if you were trying to do this problem. You could maybe think of it as a circuit problem. You could say, here's a battery, and here is one resistor in parallel with another resistor. That would be the circuit way, but here I'm just gonna kind of go through it physically. You know, the resistor fat over here, the arm fat over there. So you could say there is total R, and what is the resistance of the arm? It's rho, some other rho, some effective rho, times the length over the area. We know that, right? But we have a different composition by mass, right? So we don't know the resistivity of the arm. It's some combination of the resistivity of muscle and the resistivity of fat combined in some way. So that's the point of the problem, is to think about how they're combined, how would it work, okay? So let's go ahead and calculate or get an expression for the resistance of the fat in your arm and the resistance of your arm. So we would say, okay, the resistance of the fat and the resistance of the muscle. Let's see. So the muscle is going to be rho naught, right? Rho naught. The length of the muscle is the full length, L, over the cross-sectional area that is muscle, right? So we've got a muscle cross-sectional area and a fat cross-sectional area. So what we got to do is figure out, how does the cross-sectional area scale with those percentages? The answer is it's proportional to those percentages. So really, if this is like the percent that's fat, that's with the volume. But volume is area times length, and they have the same length. So it's really just the percentage of the area. So if we wanted to write the resistance of the fat, it would be 2 rho naught. Should do the fat first. 2 rho naught. Oh, wait, shoot. Yeah, 2 rho naught times the same length over the area, but the area that's fat is X percent, X times A, okay? Where A would just be pi times 4 centimeters squared. But the muscle would be the rho naught, just rho naught, muscle, same length, over 1 minus X times A. So that's how you would set up your two resistances, like that. All right, so let's see. So, you know, this is a tricky one, but I'm giving you an idea of how to use these concepts with an actual physical thing. I think there's a homework about body fat. I may be doing it. I didn't look at it again. Okay, so when we apply delta V to the whole thing, what are the currents? Or if we want to do, yeah, so let's apply Ohm's law to the whole thing, right? So the delta V here is the current going through the fat times 2 rho naught L over XA. And here, delta V equals the current going through the muscle times rho naught L, L over 1 minus X times A. So here we're running out of room. All right. So I think I'm going to erase this side. Okay, we have this picture in our head. And we'll finish it off over here. Now let's finish it off up here. Let's leave the picture so we can keep thinking about it here. All right. Let's see. So now we've thought about it's basically two circuits in parallel. Some current flows here, some current flows here. So if we apply the junction rule, what are we going to get? We're going to get that the total current flowing into the whole arm, I total equals I of the fat plus I muscle. Right? The current that flows into the arm, it all either goes through fat or muscle. So it's got a, so basically I'm not drawing the circuit again. If I was drawing the circuit, here would be, there's the little junction right there. Total current comes out of the battery, it breaks up into the two branches. This is in, these are both out. So that's how we get our junction rule there. So really then all we got to do is say, okay, we applied delta V, we measured some total current, and we want to get that total current in terms of X, right? X is what we're looking for. What percent fat do we have? So let's see, how could we write that? We could say how am I defining this here? We could say that I total is all that. Oh yeah, we're trying to get X in terms of I total, sorry. Okay, so what we can do is sum these up and say they're equal to I total. All right, so if we sum these up, we would say I total, the thing that it measures, right? We're trying to relate the thing that it measures to that, then it's gonna be, delta V times XA, and then these will be in the bottom, right? So this is your I fat term. Delta V times the fat, the fraction, times the cross-sectional area over 2 rho naught L. And we can just think for fun, real quick. Does this make sense? The current in one part of your arm, sure, it increases with delta V. It'll increase as you have more fat in your arm. The current going through the fat part will go up. It'll go up as area goes up. It'll go up as resistivity goes down, right? Then it'll get less as the length gets longer because the total resistance would be higher. Right? So that term kind of makes sense. Now let's add the muscle term. Right, so for the muscle, it's similar. It's delta V with 1 minus X times A. Delta V with 1 minus X times A over rho and L naught, no 2. Rho naught and L. Right, so the fat current is inherently lower by that factor of 2 because the resistivity is inherently higher by a factor of 2. Here, this isn't proportional to X, it's proportional to 1 minus X, and the reason is, if you have more percent fat, you have less percent muscle. That's just how to represent the percent muscle. Okay. So, and then I sort of turned that around and simplified it and messed with it. We wanted to solve this for X then. Okay, I see what I did, yeah. So let's go ahead and just sort of write this out for X. Because let's think, what are the like known and unknown here, right? So, I mean, it knows what voltage it applies, and we'll see, it doesn't really know the properties here. So let's just turn around and solve it for X. Really, how algebraically, I don't remember the easiest way to do it is, let's see. Yeah, there's three terms. Yeah, so let's just pull everything that's common, right? Delta V, that's something it applies and it knows. Let's pull the A out. Everything has the A. Everything has the rho naught. Everything has the L. All right. And then let's see what's left. Let's go ahead and pull the 2 and put a 2 times 2 there. So there's your common terms here. And what's left? Delta V, A. So 2 minus, on this one, what's left? X. I pull out everything except the X. Yes. And then what's left here is 2 minus 2X. Right? Over 1, over nothing. Okay. So what do we get here then? Is that we get this becomes 2 minus X up here. Right, like that. 2 minus X, like that. So this is what the total current equals. Okay, so all this stuff times 2, all this stuff minus X. So we could turn that around and solve it for X. I won't do algebra in front of you here. X equals 2. It should come out unitless. X is unitless, right? X is just a fractional percentage thing. Oh dear, I know that the fat and the muscle were stacked on each other from the problem at first. I thought the fat and the muscle were uniformly blended. Yes, this is how material science people treat things. So you're supposed to be able to do that homework until I show you this. There you go. But it's also in the book. There's a whole section about this kind of a calculation. If you're doing this class without the book, you're kind of like skydiving without a backup parachute. That would be the best analogy I can think of. You're also like resistance at constant drift velocity. 2 minus 2 rho naught L, 2 rho naught L I total over A delta V. So that is what it's doing. The scale has this expression programmed into its head, and it measures I total, and it knows the basic resistivity of muscle, 13 ohm meters. It knows 2, and it's estimating based on, you know, the length and area of what it's measuring. Okay, but is that really right? Length and area, is it getting those right? Because everybody's different. And the one I use isn't on my arm, I'm standing on it, so it's a little personal, depending on how tall you are, right? L. So how's that? Well, I total will also depend on L and A in the opposite way. So the different bodies' properties actually naturally end up canceling out in the real formula. So it's not highly sensitive to heights and diameters of legs and whatever else. Yeah. So that's how it works. I forgot what the problem in the homework exactly is. I may have just done it for you, or it may have been a more interesting combination, like two people holding hands on the scale. No. So there are more mysteries of the scale. So anyway. Okay. So that is the last purely resistive thing we're going to do. Now we're going to bring capacitors in and look at resistors and capacitors together. All right. There are further mysteries of that scale. So like, my spouse uses it, and I said, oh, I'll use it. And I got on it, and it like said my weight, and then it said like BF question mark. So of course my brain's like, she has a boyfriend? Like what? It meant body fat. It couldn't measure my body fat because I had like socks on. Okay. The insecurity runs forever. Okay, here we go. What does my wife's scale say BF? Capacity. Yes. Okay. So now what we're going to think about is what we learned about capacitors and resistors and how they behave in a circuit. And then we'll go through and really start to like combine them and think about the behavior. Okay. Okay. So capacitors and resistors, just as kind of a reminder, have opposite ways they combine. We sort of did this while we were doing the more physical descriptions, but it's also true in circuits, and I think we've kind of done it. So resistors, if they're in series, right, we know that looks like this, like that. Then the equivalent, let's do it this way, let's put it directly under. Then the equivalent resistance is just sum of them, 1 plus R2. And if we put them in parallel, right, for the resistors, right, then that is the equivalent, is this thing, this annoying thing where we have to say 1 over are equivalent equals 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2. Okay. So just the interesting thing is capacitors are completely the opposite of the formulas. This will be on the formula sheet, but you know, it's useful to also have it in your head. The capacitance, when they're in series, you have to do this. What the heck? And then when they're in parallel, you've got to just add C1 plus C2. So keep that reminding yourself that they are opposite. And if you're not sure, not sure if we have, but have we done DC circuits yet? Yeah, this has all been DC circuits. Yeah. Everything we're doing. So DC and DC circuits means direct current. It doesn't quite mean the current is constant. It means whatever happens. Oh no, we're only doing DC. Yeah. No. We're about to do RC, which is a subset of DC. Okay. DC circuits means the current might change in time, but it goes one way. It never goes back. It only goes forward. That's what direct current means. Yeah, so the whole, all last time was anything with a circuit element we've drawn is DC circuits. You might be wondering why these are different. If you're curious why they're different, if you want to think about it deeply a little bit, it's basically because resistors, the potential drop across a resistor is proportional to the resistance. V equals IR, but the potential drop across a capacitor is Q over C, that is inverse to the capacitance. That's why they come out fundamentally different. And we kind of looked at these laws and we kind of derived these in a loose way. We did not formally prove them because that's not how this class does it. Okay. So I just want to remind you of that. And we're going to start thinking about circuits that have resistors and capacitors in them. Okay. Now this gets into the part where I think we don't want to do it as complicated as we can. So I think I'm just going to do it the basic idea of putting a capacitor in a circuit, and I'll show you as far as we would go. Okay, so what I'm showing you here, and if there's homeworks that are more complicated than this, I'll take them out, because we just can't fit everything into a 13-week semester. I mean, I could just say, read these parts of the chapter. The exam will be last year's exam. But we wouldn't do that to you. No. So let's put, before we start mixing resistors and capacitors, you know, last time we did complicated resistor circuits. So those will be on the homework in the exam, you know, series and parallel and thinking that through. For capacitors, let's just talk about the basics. Capacitor in a circuit. Let's see. So let's just draw a line. I mean, probably going to be a battery, you know, and the battery is going to go to a capacitor and finish the circuit out like that. What's going to happen? Well, let's see. This is at plus E volts, and this is at 0 volts. So this wire is a metal, so it's all going to be at plus E volts, it's a wire. So this whole plate is going to be at plus E volts. 0 volts, 0 volts, 0 volts, 0 volts, 0 volts. This whole plate's going to be at 0 volts. So it's going to bring that up to E, it's going to bring that down to zero, or hold it at zero, or whatever, however you want to think about it. So to do that, to set E on the plate's charge flows from the battery. And if you want to really get into this deeply, you can really start to think about charge flow. Like, obviously, I've got to really deeply about the chemistry of the battery, or is that the last class? I don't remember. But anyway, one way to think is just the little plus Q you need flows this way, the little minus Q you need flows that way. Because then you get plus Q on this plate and minus Q on that plate. That's all that happens. Plus Q, minus Q. It's really just separating these charges. Everything remains neutral, right? Even the total capacitor is neutral. Just this plate becomes charged. The amount of charge you need on the wire is nothing to bring it up to EMF E. All right, so the charge builds on the plates. Charge flows out of the battery, builds on the plates. And then, what do you think you get? The delta V on the capacitor. What do you think it is? Well, this is plus E and this is a zero. So delta V across the capacitor has to be equal to the EMF. So how much charge flows? Well, then the Q on the capacitor has to be the EMF times C. Because that's so this is because basically it's a conductor has a constant potential. And this is because Q of C delta V always, right? So that's just how much charge a capacitor builds up. So if we had this sitting here, that's it. There's not much else to know. Maybe a little electric field in there. You can calculate how much charge is on it. I don't think I have much else to say, right? Here's one thing you could say. What if you put a switch in here? All right. With a switch and an uncharged capacitor, so say we had a switch and we have it open and the capacitor's not charged yet. Okay, so there's no charge on it, nothing's going on, and you close it. With a switch and an uncharged capacitor, close the switch. What is going to happen? Okay, well, it's going to flow current or flow charge. What does that mean? There's a brief current pulse. Close the switch, and there is a brief current pulse to charge the capacitor. So the time scale of that change is RC circuits, which we're going to be doing in like 10 minutes. Okay. But for now, you just realize this. I want you to think about that physically. If I close this, then the charge can go. And charge moving is a current. Okay. So I think what I just made the executive decision right now is that we're going to do the simplest kind of complex capacitor circuits. And just ones where it's really the kind of physical stuff we were doing before, but we draw it as a circuit. So let me show you an example. What I think we could do. Let's see. All right. So what if we had this? Think about how you would handle this. Battery, capacitor, capacitance C, another capacitor, capacitance C. Like that, EMF. So you look at that and you could say, what is the voltage? What is delta V and Q on each one? Okay. So, one way to look at it, these are actually values, these C's. I'm going to call them C naught, just because something might change in a minute. So, one way to think of it is that whole the battery is not sentient thing. The battery puts out some Q bat equals the equivalent capacitance times the EMF. So one way to look at it is you got to figure out the equivalent capacitance of this circuit. Well, it's just two capacitors in series. So you say, okay, sometimes I write it like this as a shortcut. I directly want Ceq, so 1 over C naught plus 1 over C naught and the little minus 1 there. It's just the nicer way to write it. So 1 over C naught, 1 over C naught, 2 over C naught, flip back over C naught over 2. So the charge this thing flows, so the Q from the battery equals 1/2 C naught E. Okay. So that's how much charge actually goes up. So if you're asked, what is the charging each capacitor? Well, we're having 1/2 C naught EMF flow out here. So that must be the charge here. So this one must be getting 1/2 C naught EMF on this side. And then here you have negative 1/2 C naught EMF. So you must have negative 1/2 C naught EMF here. And you must have plus 1/2 C naught EMF here. You say, but I need the total charge. But so we want to remember is in all the circuits we do, you will always have the same equal and opposite charge on either side of the capacitor. Okay, it'll polarize this piece of metal to suck up negative 1/2 C naught E here and plus 1/2 C naught E here. You don't even have to think about how is this wire getting polarized. Don't even think about that. If you have a good reason that one side gets a charge on it, like you know that's what came out of the battery and there was nowhere else for it to go, this will have the opposite. Okay, it never happens that you have unbalanced charge on a capacitor in the things that we're doing. Okay, so that would be one answer. Is what's the charge on each capacitor? 1/2 C naught EMF. And what would the other question be? What is the delta V across each one? Well, just like you can apply V equals IR to every little piece of a resistor, you can apply Q equals C delta V. Just like you can apply V equals IR to every little piece of a circuit, the whole circuit, one resistor, a branch, whatever, you can apply Q equals C delta V to the whole circuit, to a single capacitor, to a branch, blah, 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 blah. So you can do that. So you could say, so on each, you could say, well, for this one, I know that the charge Q top, well, whatever, Q equals C naught delta V cap, I'll say. They're both C naught. So what is Q? 1/2 C naught epsilon, EMF, 1/2 C naught EMF equals what? C naught delta V of the capacitor. So there you go. Each capacitor gets 1/2 of the EMF, which kind of physically makes sense, right? The whole EMF has to drop from high E here to zero, and they're the same. So symmetry would say they're going to get the same thing. So it drops from EMF to 1/2 EMF, and then again, 1/2 down to zero. But you can get that with, you know, just applying this similar path to what we do with a big resistive circuit. All right, so now let's look. Here we go. Okay, so we can't say the EMF is the voltage. Okay, yeah, so an EMF is physically a voltage, but it's the voltage applied to the entire circuit. If the EMF is applied to a single element, then yes, the EMF is a voltage on that single element. But if there's anything else, well, okay, if there's a complicated series of elements, it may not be. It usually won't be. Here it wasn't. Two things in series, the EMF of the battery won't be the voltage on each one because it has to drop and drop again, so it has to be less. The one time it could be is if you had a bunch of things in parallel. If I had two capacitors in parallel, then they would each be getting the EMF, if you think about like the wires being at constant potential. So not necessarily, okay? And that's my point. Remember with the resistors, we made all kinds of complicated networks and got the effective resistance of the whole thing and broke it into small pieces. I'm telling you, we could do all that for capacitors and do it for charge, and it's the same math, so we're just not going to. This is about as complicated as we will get for capacitor circuits because we just don't have time to practice it. Out of time, okay? But let me think. Oh, then there were other questions. So we can't say the EMF is the voltage. The charge and voltage are for each capacitor. Yeah, so I calculated it on the top, and it would be the same numbers for the bottom because they each got the same charge, because the same charge flows from the positive and negative terminal. If we have plus Q, you calculated here, the same minus Q flows out here. Yeah. So would the first... Sorry, my fingers go over. So would the first capacitor get all the voltage, leaving less voltage for the second? Yeah, so I think you're asking, like previously, somebody was thinking this one gets all the EMF. So it does not. It gets half the EMF. And this one gets the other half. So I think that question was lagging before that explanation. Are you saying most of the voltage? No, it only gets half. Yep. Okay. Cool. So I told you that we're not going to make big capacitor networks. But what could we do? I tell you we're nice, but we're not nice. We're as mean as all your other professors. We just act nice. Let's see, what could I do? You got this whole thing balanced and set up. and you're like proud of yourself, you know, and you're happy. We can't have that. Okay, so we kind of stamp that out. We're preparing you for other things here. So let's see. Happy, and you calculated all that and you got it right and you put it in Canvas and it said it was correct and you're all happy. But then we say, what if we now fill this one with a dielectric K? How does it change? Okay, so we don't have time to do all the, how every single thing changes. Let's see, what did I ask? Voltage across each, charge on each, slotted dielectric between the plates. What's the new voltage on one, new voltage on two? That'll take a long time to calculate. I'll just calculate a few things that change. So let's call this one and this two because they're now no longer the same. Let's say, what's the new CEQ? That'd be one thing you could calculate. The new CEQ would be CEQ equals 1 over C naught. That's number one. What's number two? Plus 1 over, go to your formula sheet if you don't know, put in dielectric, increase the capacitance, K times C naught, the minus 1. Yeah. So you'd realize, oh dear, let's call this K over K C naught. I multiplied it by 1. Remember learning how to add fractions, like whenever it was? And this is going to be K plus 1 over K C naught to the minus 1. So you're going to get, oh, okay. Then the answer is that it's K over K plus 1 C naught. So you could ask yourself, what did that do to the capacitance? It looks like it reduced it. Mm-hmm. And that's where you'd say, but I put a dielectric in, makes capacitance bigger. Oh, but they're in series. So bigger capacitors in series makes even less capacitance. Right? So it did the right thing. So you have the new CEQ. Okay, that's fine. You guys, what's cube at? Well, remember, the equivalent capacitance is all the battery knows, right? So, well, it's just K over K plus 1 C naught times the EMF. That's how much goes across it. So then you could say, well, in that case, what is delta V1? Like before, they shared the EMF equally. What is it now? Delta V1. How would you get it? Think for a second on your own. How would you get this? I'm rushing you through this problem. How would you get this? What have we calculated? We've calculated one key thing that's going to give it to you. This, because what was qubat for this simple circuit? All of qubat is going to go into this plate. So now we know the charge on that capacitor, right? So our charge K over K plus 1 C naught EMF equals that capacitance C naught times the delta V of 1. So the potential across 1, Q equals C delta V. And then you can see stuff cancels. Right, so it'd be the K over K plus 1 times the EMF. Is that making it bigger or smaller? Make sure that's correct. Yeah. So it's going to say the K is 2, so it's 2 over 3. So it's getting more than half of the EMF. So it goes up, right, and the other one goes down. If we went through and did the other one, you'd find that it goes down. And you would still find that if you added the two delta Vs, you'll get the EMF, okay? So I've decided that's as complicated as we're gonna get. Maybe two capacitors in series, maybe two capacitors in parallel, maybe physically messing with them. Like for example, what if I took this and said, okay, we make the plates twice as long on one of them. What have I done? It's the same problem. I've just changed the capacitance of one of them again. What if on this one, I pull it further apart by a factor of 3? What have I done? C equals epsilon naught A over D. I have physically increased that, so I've lowered the capacitance by a factor of 3. Again, I've changed it. And you have to think about, get the equivalent capacitance, get the charge out of the battery, think about what happens to each one. They could be in parallel, okay? So all I'm saying is this is as complicated as we're gonna get with pure capacitor circuits, Okay, because there's just too much going on. All right. That brings us to, yes, the break. All right, yeah, break time. After the break, we're going to talk about RC circuits. And I'll see you at 10:25.
From the home office at Jones College, it's time for the top 10 magister memes. When people ask me what it's like to be a magister, well, I think this list is sort of the best way I can express it. So here we go. Number 10. Haven't read it, I really should. Number 9. Still don't really understand it. Number 8. Ouch. Number 7. Yeah, only the seniors occasionally. Number 6. And number 5. Number 4. Probably Brown and Jones understand that one best. Number 3. Not sure about the collective portal there. I'm gonna have to think about that one. Number 2. Yes, thank you, Google Maps. And the number 1 magister meme is
All right. I reread that email, and that was $250 an hour, but only for 12 hours this summer. So I guess I'm not leaving. Yeah, I guess I'm going to stay here. But if you want to tell Lieberman that my time, word on the streets, were $250 an hour, please do.
If you're good at something, never do it for free.
Yes, words to live by. All right. Now, speaking of money, I don't know if you know, but today is the 24-hour challenge, and I am so excited because that means in 15 hours, the 24-hour challenge is going to be over. I've gotten so many emails about the 24-hour challenge. Okay, I've got a countdown clock on my phone until it's over. An email that the squirrels have opened their own 24-hour challenge. You can donate money, definitely. Damn squirrels. Okay, hold on, I need a minute. Okay, let's think about the time response of these circuits. Respond instantly. We, in our view, we have no way to think about the time response. Here we have a battery, EMF, with a switch and a resistor. And by respond, I mean when we close the switch, how fast does the current show up? Let's see. Let's plot it versus time. Let's plot the current. Let's say here's zero. Here's what that would be, the EMF over R, right? If you wanted to label the y-axis, could come up, right? And at first you have zero. If you want to get technical, the resistance here is infinity. The equivalent resistance that the battery sees is infinity plus R. Which is infinity. What current does it need to send out? EMF divided by infinity, zero. Right. So at first there's no current because the circuit is open. There's nowhere for the current to go. And then when you flip the switch, you'll go right up to EMF over R. Because now what's the resistance of a closed switch? Zero. The equivalent resistance, R plus zero. So it's just R. So the current is the EMF over R. So how fast does that happen? I don't know, instantaneous. We have no way to know how fast that happens. Okay. What if we do this? A battery again, switch again, and we have a capacitor here. Ah. And what if we plot now, since it's a capacitor circuit, we're going to plot the charge, right? And we're going to say versus time, what is the charge that flows from the battery versus time? Or the charge on the plates versus time? Now everyone think about it. Well, at first it's zero. Oh, we could figure out why. Well, it can't get past the switch because the capacitance of the open switch is zero. So if we added these two in series, you got them as the inverse, right? So the equivalent capacitance is zero, so it doesn't send any charge. All right, so zero, zero, zero. But then when you flip the switch, boom, now it's a wire with infinite capacitance. Wire has infinite capacitance, think about it. The more delta V you add, you never get any charge buildup. Infinite, anyway. So the wire, it's just a wire. The only capacitor is here, C, therefore you load it up with charge up to the amount EMF over C. Okay. And again, it happens instantly. We have no way to think about how long does it take. But what if we did this? EMF of a battery, switch, resistor, and a capacitor. R, C. Ah, that is an RC circuit. Right, so that's what we're going to figure out. So the spoiler here is that when you have a resistance and a capacitance, then that affects the rate at which the rate at which charge flows out of the battery, which is a current, and how fast it builds up on the plates. And affects a lot of other things. Okay. So that's what we're doing, is we're going to now look at the time dependence of these RC circuits. Now you might think since it's RC, it's not DC, because DC means constant. You can think that, and you're going to do fine on the exam, and you'll get through life. But that's actually not true. DC does not mean constant. It means direct. It means it only goes one direction. Direction, D, right? So direction. So an RC circuit is a DC circuit. the thing you're trying to contrast to in your mind is an AAC circuit. That's when the current goes one way, the other way, one way, the other way, one way, the other way. So this isn't going to do that. It's just going to go one way and stop. Okay. We're not doing AC circuits. So you got to take 102 if you want to see AC circuits. So I know maybe your senior year, you can take 102 as an elective. It has happened. And you can learn more electromagnetism than circuits. Let's see. What if you have multiple resistance capacitors in series or parallel? Yeah, so that's the thing I told you we're not going to cover for time. We're going to do multiple resistors in parallel, like we did last time. We're going to do simple capacitors in parallel. Oh, you mean in terms of a time circuit? I'll get to that as we go. Yeah. But basically we aren't, because, well, you'll see. You'll see. Okay, so we're going to start with something called an RC discharge. We're actually not going to put the battery in yet, okay, because that makes it even more complicated. So we're going to get as simple as we can and draw our switch here, our resistor here, our capacitor here, and that's the circuit, okay? RC. Now you may say that's the most boring circuit I've ever seen. There's no current, there's no charge on anything, and when I close the switch, there'll still be no current or charge on anything. And that could be what happens. That's what we call a trivial solution, technically. But what we're going to do is say the capacitor is initially charged. My handwriting this lecture is really bad. I don't really apologize. I mean, you know, I don't know if that's something I need to apologize for. So it's initially charged. So say there's a bunch of positive here and a bunch of negative here. Okay, so we have a charge on here. Plus Q, minus Q. And now you can see it is kind of exciting. Switch is open. That charge is going to stay there. Right? And that charge is going to stay there. This wire is net positively charged, but all of it's going to hang out on this plate because it wants to be close to this negative charge, which is also free. Okay, so usually I say a circuit is neutral. That's when a battery is driving it, right? But here we're actually claiming that, well, the whole circuit's neutral, but this branch is actually charged and this branch over here is charged. Okay, so initially charged. And then close the switch, and you can maybe tell what's going to happen when you close the switch. The positive is going to go this way, the negative is going to go that way, they're going to cancel, and the whole thing's going to be neutral. But how fast? Close the switch, charge flows to, I don't know how to say it, cancel, what we're looking at, how fast? Is that instantaneous? You know, if I were to plot the charge on the capacitor versus time, right, would it be, okay, we had some charge, we flew the switch, and instantly to zero? No, it's going to take time. And we're going to figure out how much. Here we go. We need to apply, so we have to do it mathematically, unfortunately. So let's do it mathematically. Let's look at Kirchhoff's. Nope, it's not. Oof. Loop rule. So this is a case where we have to use a loop rule. You are not going to have to use a loop rule because this is a simple RC is really the only one we're going to do. Because basically every different complicated one circuit, it has a big complicated thing with switches everywhere. You have to write a series of differential equations and solve them. So really all of our problems are really just a simple R and C in series. Anything else is like a whole nother math problem. So we're just gonna walk through the case of R and C in series, okay? Let's see, so loop rule means what do you do? Loop rule, you gotta pick a way you're looping. And you walk through and you think about the delta Vs, the potentials, the potential drops or increases, the potential changes, and they have to sum to zero, right? So remember, it's basically the sum of all the delta Vs around the loop zero. Actually, I put a loop here. We're summing around the loop all the different delta Vs. Okay. And they got a sum of zero. We also have to, we can draw it that way. Everything's getting backwards. We also need to assume a current direction. Now they need to be drawn the other way. So go in your notes here. I meant to put the positives on this side. So it'll match my notes. Otherwise there'll be a negative sign flying around that won't cancel till the end and everybody will panic. Okay. So it's initially set where the positive charges are here, the negative charges are there. The loop, we're gonna loop clockwise, and the current flow is also going to be clockwise. I'm describing the current with a lowercase I. One sort of convention people use is capital letter means it's a constant, like what we've been doing. All those currents were constant, but a lowercase means it might vary. Okay, so my little I means, oh, this might change in time. And I have to say the current direction because when you do Kirchhoff's loop rule, remember, you got to define the loop direction you're looping and the direction of the current. You can always make the direction of current. Sometimes in a complicated circuit, you have currents flowing in different directions, so you can't always make a match. In this case, yeah, let's just make the loop match the current direction, so it causes less confusion. All right, so do we think we're smart enough to apply the loop rule here? Remember, we've closed the switch now, so yeah. So the same current is flowing everywhere. There's no branches, so we have the same current throughout the whole circuit. All right, so let's loop. The hustle, here we go. This is just wires. And now we're looping through a resistor. What's the potential difference across the resistor as we loop this way? Think about that for a second. See if you can come up with what it is. What is the delta V of that resistor? Ohm's law, delta V equals IR. So in terms of things we were given, it must be IR. Now the harder part, is it positive or negative? I can pull through my notes. I don't actually know. It is negative, right? Because current always flows from the high potential to the low potential. Deltas always mean final minus initial, right? So if it's final is lower than the initial, it's going to be negative IR. Negative IR, okay? So that's one drop. What about the potential difference of the capacitor? Think about that. What is that? How do capacitors work? Q equals C delta V. It must be Q over C. Right? Is it positive or negative? It's positive, right? Because we're going from the negative low potential to the high. Final minus initial, high minus low is going to be positive. Plus, I'm going to also write little q over c. Just to remind you, we're not talking about a time-changing current. So at any moment in time, these would be lowercase. You would say maybe they started at big Q or something. Okay. Okay, so that is your only, those are your only potential drops. And they have to be equal to zero. All right, pretty boring. Not much of an equation, is it? So we need to do something to it. Well, we're trying to describe what? We're either trying to describe the charge in a function of time, or maybe we're describing the current as a function of time. I don't know. We could do either one, but you got to pick one. We're either going to write this in terms of current or write this in terms of charge. One or the other. Let's have a vote. Who says the first thing in the chat? Charge or current? Oh, I hope you say charge, because I actually can't do it for current. Somebody talk. Ah, bastard. Charge, there you go. Sorry I called the first person a bastard. I'm worried it was somebody I know. Well, I hope it is somebody I know, because then she'll understand. I just saw an S. It's okay. We're going to do it in terms of charge. See everybody else wants charge. Oh, no, it was somebody I don't know. I apologize. All right, so here's what we're going to do. What we got to do is we're going to say, if we're going to do it in terms of charge, I. What is I? We have to write I in terms of the charge. And what are we going to have to do? Oh, dear. Yes, calculus is involved. We know the current is the time rate of charge, right? dQ dt. And even more complicated, we have to remember to put a negative sign in there, right? Because the current we get is a discharge. The bigger the current, the faster dQ dt is going down. So in this case, I actually equals negative d DQDT. That's right. So what we can do now, we're going to do like the scrolling chalkboard here. We have Kirchhoff's loop rule, and we have I equals minus DQDT. Yeah. And you see, for the person who said current, you can do it in current. We would have to write this as an integral, and then we have like an integral equation. So we want to just write this nice, simple differential equation. That's the reason. All right. So, so we're going to say, we're going to plug that into there. And we're going to get minus and another minus cancel. So we get, I'll put the constant out front, R dQ dt. See, putting that in there, that in there. Negatives cancel, plus Q over C, right, equals zero. Okay. Now remember, Q is a function of t, right? That's just an awkward way to write that. Q is not a constant, little q, changing in time. So we've got a function of time and its derivative. I'm sensing a huge lag, but hopefully it's not too bad for you. Yeah, it's probably bad. How do we know the top part of the resistor is positive and the bottom part is negative? So that's always true for a resistor. If the current is flowing this way, current is the flow of positive charge carriers. So they will always flow from the high potential to the low potential. So that's just a rule for resistors. If you move with the current, it's always a negative delta V when you're doing the loop rule. No lag, good, okay, it's just me. You would think I would have the most unlaggy one, but I'm like right here. Okay, so this is a differential equation. Oh my God, this is not even, we're not just having to do integrals, we're doing differential equations here. So, you know, differential equations is a whole class because it's hard to solve various ones. They don't understand that you're guessing the answer and everything. This one you can kind of solve, kind of cheating a little bit. You're kind of treating derivatives as algebra and whatever. But you can do it. So let's simplify this one a bit. And let's get it, usually a differential equation, you want to get it in terms of the derivative. You want to isolate the derivative in this case. So if we solve this for dq dt equals minus q over c here over c here, let's then divide by the r. Then we get dq dt is minus q over rc. And this is a pretty famous kind of differential equation here. It's where the rate of change is proportional to the amount, right? That means the more charge on here, the faster it's going off. And if the amount of charge here goes really low, it goes off slower. That's like how I would describe that in words, okay? But we don't just want words, we have to actually solve it. All right, so let's see. So the way you sort of solve this differential equation is you get Q's on one side, T's on the other. All right, so we bring this over here and it becomes dQ over Q equals minus dT over RC, like that. And then we integrate. And we have to think about the limits of integration for this physical situation. Okay? So we're starting with a charge, say Q naught, and it's going to zero. So we're going to say Q naught, well, I mean, Q is a function of time. So let's say Q of zero equals Q naught at time equals zero. Is that how we want to do it? I need to write these limits out a little more detail so you understand what I'm talking about. Let me just keep scrolling the chalkboard here. There we go. So we're solving this, right? So let's apply limits. What we care about is at time equals zero and at time equals t, right? So what I mean is we're going to integrate from the original condition to some time t. In an advanced math book, they would put a prime on here. One would have a prime, one wouldn't. I find that confuses people more than it helps. So let's not do that. At time equals zero, what's the charge? Q0. At time equals T, later T, what is the charge? It's just some Q.
It's just some.
It's the function we're looking for, Q of T. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to integrate this thing. We're going to integrate this side, which is the charge, from Q0 to some Q. And that's going to be dQ over Q. And on this side, dT over RC, we're going to integrate it from what? 0 to T. So it looks something like that. Okay. It's okay. This is all calculus you can handle. Not really going to have to do it. You just going to have to use the answer. But I'd like you to have some idea where it came from. Okay. So what's the integral of dQ over Q? Well, it's like maybe you've heard of dx over x or the integral of 1 over x. Maybe this sounds familiar. It's the natural log of Q. We have to apply the limits from Q0 to Q. Okay, this is the variable Q. This is the original Q, and this is the final Q after some time t. So this is essentially giving us the function we're looking for here. And what's the integral of dt? Well, it's just t, right? So minus t over rc evaluated from 0 to t. All right, well, let's evaluate these. So this is natural log of q minus natural log of q0. If you know how your natural logs work, which I'm sure you do, when you subtract two natural logs, it's the same as the ratio of those two natural logs. So ln q minus ln q0 is ln q over q0. Oh, yeah. And here, t over rc evaluated t, this is t over rc, minus evaluated 0, this is 0. All right, so minus t over rc. All right. What are we doing here? We're trying to figure out what this q is. How does this q depend on t? Q at time t depends on t somehow. All right, well, how do we deal with this? We take the exponent of both sides, which I like to cartoonishly do by drawing a big E down there. So we took the exponent of the natural log of q over q0. So another thing to know about how natural logs work is, what is e to the natural log of x? X, right? So this becomes q over q0. And this is still just minus e to the t over rc. Mm-hmm. And then for final, if we want, how does q depend on time? It's q0 e to the minus, e to the minus t to the rc. Sorry, I put the minus in the wrong place. E to the minus t over rc. So that is how the charge varies on the capacitor if you started at q0. This is called exponential decay. All right, so let's see. Let's just bask in it for a minute. Do you want to calculate things or do you want to bask in it? Exponential decay. Let's calculate some things and we'll bask in a minute. Yeah. I will leave basking time. So in terms of how this goes down, let's plot one. You may know what an exponential decay plot looks like. Here, if I'm plotting Q versus time, it's going to start at Q0. Because what if time equals 0? If we plug 0 into this, what do we get? 0. What's e to the 0? 1. Anything to 0 is 1. Q equals Q0. Look at that. If we let time get really big, let's plug something big in here. Oh, did I just go away? No, I think I'm here. I think my... Okay. I'm just going to... If I see lots of people upset that you can't hear me, I'll worry about it.
Everything's fine for me.
It's good. Okay. Yeah, it's just me. Here we go. Okay. So anyway, what we're going to do is think our way through it and say to ourselves, what would happen if time were really big, right? And if time were really big, t big, you'd have e to the minus something big. And e to the minus means 1 over. So you'd have 1 over e to the big. And what is e to the big? Big. What's 1 over big? 0. Right? So this thing is going down, is what I'm trying to say. And according to exponential decay, as a function you've seen before, it goes down like that. Okay? That's what it would look like. exponential decay. So how fast? And we characterize how fast by the RC time constant. All right. Okay, so the RC time constant. So if you look at it, this is the way exponentials behave. If you have like a big number under here, it goes down slow, and a small number, it goes down fast, right? A small number here means this whole thing is big. If this thing is big, it's a fast exponential. And if this thing is a really big RC, a long time, then the thing is small. That's why. So you can take the circuit and you can literally multiply the resistance times C. And we can even think about the units, right? This would be ohms and this would be farads. What is an ohm? It's a volt per amp. Right? V equals IR. Yeah, V equals IR, V over I, so yeah, a volt per amp. And what's a farad? Q equals C V, so it's charge, it's Q over volts. All right, Q over V. I think that's what I was trying to write down. Oh no, Q coulombs. Yeah, we're doing units. Maybe something was wrong. Yeah, coulombs. So we look at that, we cancel these, and we get a coulomb per amp. All right, but what is an amp? It's a coulomb per second. So we have coulombs over coulombs per second. All right, and what is that? Seconds. All right, so RC really is in seconds. You multiply an ohm times a farad, and you get something that comes out in seconds. Okay, so there's some special places. If we go to the point where T equals RC, like the actual, you know, it's going down at all times, but we consider the RC a special place, right? And if you say how much charge is left on there, it's like 37% or something. So sometimes you say, what is it at the RC time constant? It'll always be 37% of Q naught. That's all. So exponential decay, you may have seen it in other places. So now let's just set up a quick numerical version of this, and then I'll maybe give you a hint of how we could complicate it if we wanted to. Discharge here. Plug in some numbers, make us feel better here. So let's say we had something like this. Switch 2 kiloohms and a capacitor, 2 kiloohms and 50 nanofarads, typical electronics setup. And let's say it's charged. So it has, you know, plus, 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 minus, 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 Q, Q naught, an initial charge. Initial charge Q naught, close switch, when is the Q of the capacitor equal 1/2 of Q naught? Right. When is that going to happen? Well, we know the charge on the capacitor. Q is a function of time. We can write big Qs now since we wrote the initial in terms of Q naught. Doesn't matter. Q is a function of time. Is Q naught e to the minus t over RC? So we say, okay, when is that going to be? How do we do this? We don't know the initial charge, but you don't need the initial charge because we're just trying to get it down to half. All right, 1/2 Q naught equals Q naught e to the minus t over RC. All right, like that. So then you say, oh yeah, I don't need, right? I was just asked this fractional question. That often happens in exponential decay. So then you'd say, okay, I have a half that. I need to put some numbers in here. You could, rather than plugging in a complicated there, the first thing you could do is solve for RC time constant. Multiply 2,000 times 50 times 10 to the minus 9, and you're going to get 100 microseconds. This times that. So then you could say, okay, I'm going to come over here. Now, my t that I need is here in this exponent. So we're going to do this, take the natural log of both sides. Right? Before we took the exponent of both sides, because we had a log we need to get rid of. Now I have an exponent we want to get rid of. Take the natural log of both sides. Natural log of 1/2
natural log of e to the something is minus is the something minus t over 100 microseconds. That's not any better. Okay.
So then, well, you just do the natural log of a half in your calculator and you solve it, etc. And if you think about it, you should get something at least of a similar order of magnitude here, because we know this thing is going to decay, right? And we know that 100 microseconds is where it's at, like we said, 37%. And we're asking how much charge is it at, or how long does it take to get 50% down? So we should probably get something between 0 and 100 microseconds. So just something to look for. You know, if you ask for halfway down, it should be a little quicker than the RC time constant. And here you get 69 microseconds. Or microseconds, yeah. And that's what we call the half-life. Right, if you're asked how long does it take the charge to get to half its value, half-life. Right. So, in the final 4 minutes, let me tell you two quick things. So there's also charging a capacitor, which we may just leave out. One thing is you could do it. What is the current? You could do that, right? Because you know that Q is Q naught, E to minus T over RC. How are we going to get the current? Oh my God. How are we going to get it? Right? You'd have to take the derivative. Oh dear. So derivative of this, Q naught's just along for the ride. E, take the derivative of the thing in the exponent. So that's minus 1 over RC, E to the minus T over RC. All right, so, and then that's a time constant. So you can see Q naught over RC. So I naught is Q naught over RC. Because if you plot this, it kind of looks like this. Current versus time, it's also exponential decay, where this is I naught. So when you close it, you'll be a burst of current, of charge coming off the plates. That's an initial current, but eventually the charge will stop coming off the plates because there's no charge left. So that's the current going to zero. And then here's your little formula. Basically, you get I equals I naught e to the minus the same times constant, e to the minus t over RC. So in physics, okay, before we get into the big point, you're asking, do you have to do this for other kinds of circuits? So the answer is basically no. If we set up different kinds of combinations of resistors and capacitors in a circuit, you know, then we're going to discharge this, though. I bet you could do this. What if we were going to discharge this capacitor? Maybe you can see that this really is just a resistor and a capacitor in series. You would just have to use 2R and that's C. So we could do things like that. But if we make complicated branches, it would have to be a new differential equation that we'd have to integrate in a new way. And we don't even do that in 102. That's like, it's very pointless and advanced. All right, so big picture, physics. What's physics all about? Finding a small set of equations that describe a lot of different phenomena. Okay, so what I just described to you is one of those cases. Okay, so the discharge of a capacitor is simply exponential decay. And exponential decay describes radioactive decay and population dynamics. Anytime the rate that something goes away is proportional to how much is left, that's exponential decay. And in terms of discrete objects, anytime you have a population of objects and each one has the same chance of going away per unit time, also leads to exponential decay, because the rate that ones are leaving will depend on how many are there. Those are both cases of exponential decay. I tried to find a good biology example. Biology don't like math, so I couldn't find one, but the Ig Nobel Prize was given out by some biologists who studied how fast a head of beer gets smaller, and every bubble has the same chance of popping per unit time. So the head of beer follows exponential decay, or the head of any carbonated drink that you may want to stare at. You can point out to your friends, watch this exponential decay. Yes, okay, so I'm gonna let you out 10 seconds early, and I'll see you next week.